You're listening to the SWN podcast.
And this is SWN.
Welcome to SWN.
Skull! Skull! Skull!
This is SWN.
And this is the Scottish Wrestling Network.
Where Scottish wrestling lives, I guess. Is that a tagline? I guess. I don't know.
Hello and welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I'm your host as always, Billy. I've turned it on as soon as I hit record. This episode is going out at the end of April, but it's being recorded on WrestleMania Sunday. So I am just warning you now, if you thought that I could be as I've forgotten words already, stay tuned. This is going to be an interesting hour. I am joined on this edition by the meatiest tag team in Scottish professional wrestling. A returning guest on the podcast in Craig Berry.
Hello.
And for the first time, I don't know if I'm popping his podcast cherry, I'm joined by John Kerr as well.
You are indeed. Hello.
What a night. So yeah, I'm looking forward to this. This is one of the ones I've been trying to maybe get some tag teams on, just to freshen up so people don't have to hear my voice so often, because I've done like 200 and I'm nearing 300 of these, so I assume people will be fed up of me. So this took a little bit of trying to figure out a date between the three of us to fit it in. And somehow we landed it on WrestleMania Sunday. So, yeah, we're asleep. Did you watch WrestleMania? Did you both watch it Saturday?
Yes, I did.
I fell asleep right as it started. So there was just no chance.
So Craig's terrible. Craig's the freshest one of the bunch here. Oh, yeah. I'm on fire. This is great. Right, so... Usually, I would do like how you got started wrestling. I've done that with Craig already for two episodes, episode 8 and episode 126. And this will be episode 264. So,
Jesus.
I know. How have I strung this concept out for so long? I don't know. And this is the first time I'm speaking to you, John. It's unbelievable. So, we'll probably find out a bit more about your beginnings in professional wrestling, and then we'll just get into the big meaty content of the podcast, where we talk about the big lads into the meat factory, and I've got questions from our listeners as well. So that'll be good fun as well. So we'll start with you, John. How did you get into pro wrestling? So what was the moment of your fandom? We'll go for the cliche questions first. What was your moment of fandom that got you into professional wrestling?
I mean, I've always loved wrestling. I mean, I think that's what everyone says, but it's true. I've always been that. I was always that wrestling kid. And it was just, I think it's a funny story, but I don't know what it actually is. I was doing a performance in school in year three for my drama, and me and my mate, who are really into wrestling, done a whole wrestling match, and it was the worst thing you've ever seen in your life. And I jokingly put it on Facebook. And once I put it on Facebook, it was Nathan Reynolds. He was friends with stepdad, and he messaged and said, "Look, does he want to come and train?" And I took that up. I took the opportunity so quick, and that was me hooked. I went for a session. That was it from then. It was no looking back.
That's a fairly that's a very unusual way to get into wrestling.
I'm an unusual guy.
There's the tagline for the episode. So. Yeah, I'm just digesting that. So you put on a match you thought was absolutely horrendous on Facebook, and then a wrestler contacted you and went, maybe we should try this. that doesn't feel like it bodes well generally, but
somehow it worked out. It's worked somehow. So.
Exactly, and it's led us here to talk about professional wrestling and a good old jolly. So who are your favorites growing up?
There's too many names going in my head. I think for me, my growing up was obviously I was a massive John Cena kid. Loved them always. But then as I slightly started getting older, I got really into Bully Ray when he was in TNA. And that kind of took me over, and I just lived the whole of my youth just watching Bully Ray. And he was the one that really something about him I just loved.
The calves, right? It's the calves.
That's exactly what it is.
And it led you guys to be a meat factory. Calves, meat. This is all just coming together now. This is
all makes sense.
It is. So from then, started training randomly from a. Is it still on Facebook?
It will be. It will be still on Facebook somewhere.
Bear with me for a moment. No, it's okay. I won't do it while we're recording anyway. I'll do it afterwards and put it at the end as a post credit. I won't. I might. I won't.
Maybe when I say a wrestling match, I mean it was mats on a floor in a school with no wrestling training at all, just hitting RKOs and action adjustments on each other for about 12 minutes. That's all this was. It was just an absolute massacre of whatever it was.
People still
it's amazing. It is a funny watch.
People pay tickets for that nowadays, though. Well, they get given away tickets for it, maybe. There we go. Moving on. So not going to get the controversy in straight away. So from that point onwards, you started wrestling in Dundee, of all places, for your sins. And how did we get from when you started wrestling? How did we get into? We'll just get into the meat factory because I know Craig's sitting there. Like you can kind of join in.
No, honestly, Kev, have your moment. I've been on this twice now, so
I know which we get both forgot.
We both forgot, but still,
yeah. So a lot of matches, though. Okay, well, we'll go back to John. You can have a break or something if you want.
Yeah.
So you started wrestling 2017. I've got noted here as your first match on your cage match profile, that exists. If anyone wants to go check it, it definitely exists. Against Nathan Reynolds was one of your first matches. Then a couple of months in, according to this anyway. So how did you feel when you actually got to the training side of things? Did you feel like you got a feel for it straight away? How long was it between training and actually getting in the ring?
It was a weird. I remember walking into the building, and I remember like at the time when you know, so most people know it's like when you walk in a training school. But I remember looking at most of these people and was what they were doing in the ring, and I thought, how is that even? How am I ever going to get to a level where I can do that? But I was watching it, and I remember I remember getting in the ring, doing warm-ups. I got in, and I just remember it was everything I thought it was going to be, and I just loved it. And I remember I got told about my third or fourth train session in. Someone came up to me, and they'd say, look, we think you've got something, so let's stick in, let's get this going. And then I think it was probably roughly about a year and a half, maybe, after I started. They came to me, offered me my first match, and I took the chance, and it was I can't really remember the match, but I'm going to assume it was amazing. So it was with Nathan Reynolds, I think he said, and he was a phenomenal worker.
Definitely one of the first ones, anyway. That again, this is what Cage Match offers me when it comes to writing notes. So there's probably a lot missing, but we'll go with what we've got. Just out of curiosity then, you did a little bit of wrestling with your pal on mats. Did you do backyard, and or did you have, because I've asked this recently of other, Kate Calloway, who I'm probably going to bring up later in this interview, we're talking about trampoline wrestling and all that kind of stuff. Was there a John Kerr before there was a John Kerr?
There was on the trampolines with some friends. There was definitely John Kerr before, but weirdly, I think I always look back every time I look at something, every time I go to it and I'm in a match, I always end up somehow thinking to myself, how am I here? Because I remember myself on my trampoline in my back garden with three of my mates just hitting each other. And I remember I think back to that and think, how have I went from there to where I am now? And it's mind-boggling. It's mental.
What was the gimmick? I this is like this is the most fascinating thing I found about wrestlers. Like I did it as well, but I didn't have that much of an imagination. I was Jeff Hardy because I like climbing stuff. What was the gimmick?
At the time, it was just basically copying Bully Ray. That was it. I just walked around and I just jokingly in gimmick bullied everyone on the trampoline, and then most of them just jumped on top of me, and that was it. That was mostly it. But no, it was a mix. I'd say Bully Ray and John Cena. It was just a weird gimmick.
Big, did you I can't remember if we've talked about this before, but did you do a little bit of the old "don't try this at home," but I did it at home kind of thing?
Oh yeah, yeah, 100%. Like, yeah, I think anyone who says they didn't is a liar, and yeah, they're just embarrassed about it. But no, I definitely did do it.
I like being of an age where it was just "don't try this at home." So I was like, I do it at school, it's fine. And then when I left school, it came up with "don't try this at home or at school." I was like, ah, loophole. I got past that. That's fine. So from that point onwards, you spent a couple of years in Dundee, a couple matches against names that I recognise, like King Caden and Tommy Cross, names that you've come across in Fair City Wrestling as well.
Yeah.
What was it like getting involved just doing that? I'm seeing Jack Morris thrown in there. It was a rumble, so I don't know if you actually got in about with Jack Morris, but there's a good base of names in there, Ian Ambrose as well. So I know you said that you every time you wrestle, you're like, oh my God, how am I at this point? But just what was it like actually just getting in about and actually doing the wrestling?
Oh, it's mental to... I got in and I got put in originally in a group, and Jack Morrison in the group. There was now my brother-in-law was in the group as well. And it was just, I remember every time we were out, we're doing whatever we're doing, and I was learning all this stuff, because I was mostly, at the start, I was kind of just being a manager or kind of outside the ring, being there. But I remember just watching everything and learning, and I just remember thinking, this is the bit. It's still to this day, it's the best thing ever, just being able to watch and learn how something works. And when it's something that you've loved since you were a child, like wrestling, you even slightly start to understand how amazing this sport is. It's the best thing in the world. And it's such a complex and confusing sport. But when you slightly start to get it, it's just the best thing in the world.
I've found that when I take my wife to shows, she only goes to live shows. She doesn't really care about watching. She was staying up. She's going to be in bed at a reasonable hour because she's a grown-up, but she doesn't care about watching TV, but she goes to see it live. I've got to kind of had to last year tell her about how a ladder match worked, and she was like, that sounds stupid. And then she watched it and went, oh, that was really good actually. I was like, I told you, wrestling's cool.
It's cool, all of it's cool.
I promise you, honestly. Please keep coming. I don't want to be alone at shows. So from that point onwards, you lot of singles action, but tag matches here and there, and then you're into Fair City Wrestling, straight into the junior heavyweight title scene as well. And one of the first shows, I think, wasn't it? It was a big.
It was, yeah. The first show was the tournament. I was in the first round against Ken Caden.
So again, new company. I don't know if you'd wrestled in Perth before with the other company at that
point. I think I've done a couple, but
it was. I remember that show went up on online, so I watched it. I don't want to really go back and read the review, because if I was mean about it, then I really don't want to awkwardly talk about it here. I don't think I was, though. I don't remember giving you a bad review on any shows. And
I'll pay that.
Well, hopefully, because recently I did it with Lee McRae, back in the archives. I was really nice to him about a review. Apparently, I wasn't nice enough, and he called me out on it on the podcast. I'm like, I was nice. Be alone. But
well, an opinion.
Yeah, exactly. I'm gonna be harsher on you next time now. Sorry, Lee. You're not listening. I don't care. Right, anyway, so from that point onwards then, what was the kind of point from there into Fair City Wrestling? Maybe moving away from Dundee initially, and then getting into Fife Pro Wrestling Asylum at the time, to then how fast was it from that point to getting into the big lads, as it was known at the time?
It was from a step away from Dundee into, because at the time, Fair City came around the same time I was in Dundee as well. So I was kind of doing both. And then it was Showcase Championship I had. And I remember I had that and I thought to myself, I went, I don't think I should have this. And I was like, I don't think I'm at a level where I deserve to have a title. So I thought to myself, I need to go somewhere that's, I'm going to start at the bottom of the pile again. Because I just, at the time, felt like it was, even though I was nowhere near the level that I wanted to be, not even slightly close, I was it was kind of like you were getting put in the positions where you were at that level, and I just didn't like it. Mm. So I'd done the Fair City shows, and I'd done some of the shows in Dundee, and then Power Pro opened. And I remember at the time, I was a bit, I wanted to go right at the start, but I'm a very nervous guy, so new, but I don't like change. So I was happy, I wasn't happy where I was, but I was happy staying where I was. I didn't want to change. And I remember looking at it, seeing videos, seeing the social medias, I thought, yeah, that's where I need to be. And I moved, and I'm not even just saying it, it was the best thing I've ever done. It was just such a step up in every way imaginable. And it's just amazing.
I suppose it's a case of if you're holding a title in a environment where it's maybe not like the most, I don't want to say respected, but not the most respected environment. Holding a title there is kind of like you're just holding it for holding its sake. Whereas you want to be a wrestler, so you wanted to to pursue finding a school that might afford you further opportunities into to other ventures, and having Andy Roberts, Andy Roberts. I'm not going to confuse myself by going what his name was at the time and now. Andy Roberts and knowing what he's done is beneficial for you entirely. For yourself, Greg, then, do you remember how did you guys kind of connect at that point? Were you in the same kind of classes? Was it just a random chance meeting? Where did this come from, this team?
We're in the same classes. He joined a couple of weeks after we opened, I'm sure. That's right, Kerry. It was a couple of weeks, wasn't it?
No, it was a couple of months after.
It was a couple of months.
It was just before COVID.
Yeah, you're right. That was it. Yeah. So, yeah, he had came in. We got on back and forth. We didn't really talk, to be honest, though. It was like, it was just, yeah, we were two similar guys. And I think that's why we didn't want to, like, maybe getting involved with each other, because we're like, nah, we're too similar. We need to like separate a bit, you know, because try not to get the same gimmick and all that kind of thing. And then I remember it was like the time of the first show was coming up, and like we knew each other. We weren't talking, we weren't really friendly that much, but we didn't hate each other, so we obviously talked to each other. But the first show was coming up, like England Office at Studio 8, and they needed a team. You need two tag teams. Roy had one tag team, but he also needed another one for the student showcase. And I had leveled up myself quite a bit. John had always been phenomenal, like as he always is. He's absolutely fantastic. But I really started to like level up myself and actually get better, lose weight, you know, get better technically. And I think it was just he'd seen us that day and thought, yeah, I'm gonna try use two together just for something. We'll call you the big lads, just go out there and try something, and if it works, it works. If not, then it was something. So me and John, I think, started speaking more at that point and just said, right, screw it, let's just try it. And the big lads were decent enough, I think, so that's how we're still here.
So is there a competitive nature then between the two of you, I think? Because like you're saying, you guys are kind of similar build, probably similar attributes as well, so you're both competing for possibly the same spot on a show. So was there, you say you didn't really speak to each other though, but was there a competitive edge between the two of you going, oh, what's he up to? Oh, I better step up this a little bit here because he's probably going for the same spot that I've got.
Maybe like subconsciously, yeah, but like I don't think we ever like said it to each other or anything like that, but yeah, probably subconsciously, because it's true what you say, it's like similar builds. There's, you know, obviously we'd probably go for the same spot on a card, but we don't have to worry about that anymore because obviously we're a team, so it's like, oh, we are the spot on the card. But probably back then, maybe, but I don't think we, I don't know, Kerr, did you ever feel like that?
Yeah, I'll say it, yeah. You go, like, I walked in, you see Craig, you know, he's been training there, so you're like, right, like Craig saying. Similar build, we're going for the same spot on the card, but we always talked, but like friendly when we went in. There was never an issue. But we were just I was thinking at the time, like, that's the guy you need to beat. And it was, and I knew the minute I walked in, it was going to be hard, because he was very good when I went in, and he's even better now. So he's unreal. But it got to a point, I feel, where it was the one, I don't know if you remember, it was one training session where we were doing matches, and me and you got paired together.
And oh, I remember. We put on
a phenomenal match. It was unreal. And then it was that point we just started talking to each other, and then we like made a fantasy of this tag team. And then lo and behold, about a month later, there was a first show announced at Power Pro, and we were together, and we were like, right, let's make this happen.
Mm. I still want to get a singles match though with you at one point. Like, I don't care how it has to happen. If it has to be a friendly between us two, like, you know, we're not breaking up. Don't worry. Like, I love you, and we'll be together forever. But I definitely want this match to happen at some point. Like, because, like, Bella, you didn't see it, but we beat the shit out of each other, man. It was
brilliant.
I was gonna say, was it Braun Strowman and Big Show when they started doing lucha stuff and randomly, and it's like, why, how are these guys doing this? Or was it just, like you're saying, was it just like you guys just wailing on each other for a good couple of minutes? And
it was both.
Yeah, a little bit.
It
both.
Started with us doing lucha stuff, and then it just kind of ended up going into this, let's just try and break each other's noses. Yeah. it's just at each other.
And that was the moment you decided that you were going to be best friends forever.
That was it.
So, outside of wrestling, is there any other than wrestling, of course, I'm assuming that's going to be a crossover interest. But was there anything else you were able to connect upon? I know, Craig, you're big into your board games and whatnot, tabletop games, if I remember rightly. Was there any crossover to kind of to secure this new friendship?
Feud.
Oh, fair.
Food.
That makes sense.
Me. Don't even laugh, Kerr. Don't even laugh. That's true.
It was food.
Yeah, there's a theme here. Like, it's not, this is where you find it. This isn't actually a gimmick. This is just us. It's like, come on.
It's weird that me and Craig are together, because Craig's like really into his anime. He's really into his board games, video games, and I love like my football. I love loads of stuff, but we don't really love like the same stuff.
No.
I always think that's why it works so well. It's because we both just got completely different ideas, but we can bring them together and kind of pick and make them work so well. But there's always, I mean, Craig's been trying for ages to get me into anime.
It will happen eventually. It slightly happened,
I'll admit. It slightly happened, but I've been told you about that. Victories. Yeah. You will come to a football game with me one day. But yeah,
honestly. As long as it's not
Easter. Like you said, it was food. It was before a show, we went for food together just randomly. And we were like, oh, that was the real competition. I was like, I'm eating more than this guy. I'm getting a larger plate. That's just not happening.
Oh, I love that.
That was a draw.
Do you remember where it was? Just for recommendation.
Where was that game there? Was that Bayesian banquet across the road? No,
it was.
Where was it?
I want to say it was a McDonald's.
That's blasphemy already, because we're a KFC team.
Yeah, but we weren't in a location where KFC was available, so we had the other one, which is nowhere near as good as KFC. KFC, if you watch this, I love you. Sponsor me, please, and the meat factory.
Yes, sponsor us, please. Billy, sorry, quick question. Turn it around on you.
Go for it.
McDonald's or KFC?
I'm a KFC guy. But
okay, you're good.
The KFC in Elgin is dire. So I have to be a McDonald's guy in Elgin. But if I have the choice, it's KFC.
It's KFC, yeah. That's a respectful answer.
Okay. Yeah.
I've been to Elgin. It doesn't look the best.
It was weird. The KFC opened. There you go, first tangent. So the KFC opened, and it started the first couple of months ended up like serving like green chicken. It was reported like green chicken appeared at times, and it was rotten food and all that stuff. And the KFC is still here, but it's pretty much dead a lot of the time because they shot the bed at the start, and it's kind of just really recovered from there.
No return.
But I'll still occasionally go there, but they generally never get my order right. But, you know, love the chicken. I've got to get my 99p spicy wings to go with everything else. It has to be done. It's my hangover cure.
Right. What's your order at? We're gonna stay on this tangent for like another minute. What's your order for KFC? Because this is where we really start to judge you.
Well, generally I'm going with Mrs. So we just go for like the biggest possible boneless banquet kind of thing. So usually it's the 4-person one between the two of us, because we're greedy fuckers like that. so I would go with that. If I'm going for myself though, I'm panicking because I can't actually remember what anything's called. So I've literally got the menu up in front of me, so I remember. Yes. There we go. But usually it's a box meal, if I remember rightly. Let's see. This is fantastic content. next to nothing on here. Their website's poor.
It is.
Usually, like,
I actually think it's the best website ever designed, personally, mate.
Oh, yeah. Sorry. I apologize.
Sorry, you're going for that sponsor, Kerry. Sorry.
Go get it one day. KFC will sponsor me.
I can't remember. It used to be called like a mega something, but it was like a chicken burger with onion ring, cheese, and bacon in it.
I remember that.
Yeah, remember that.
With a box meal. But generally, if you give me something like boneless and just loads of it, then I'm kind of good to go.
That's respectable.
Yeah, yourselves.
Remember that bucket you just said there. Now you and your wife, well, your wife, yeah. Sorry,
yes,
I'm terrible with remember relations.
Possibly, no. Actually, it was always my wife since I've started this podcast. But yes, carry on.
There we go. So remember that bucket you said that you used to get. Yeah, well, me and Kerry get one of them each, and that's we're good to go.
The sad thing is, he's not even lying.
Is it the party bucket?
Was lying. I was like, hang on a minute, Kerry. No, I'm not lying.
Is it the party bucket? 14 piece, 8 milli fillets, 8 hot wings, all that kind of stuff.
That's it.
And then whatever added extras we normally add on.
Usually another box on top, but
I used to be able to eat like that. I don't know what's happened in my 30s, but it's gone downhill. I can't do it. I can't do it like I used to.
It's because you need more meat factory content in your life. That's what it is.
And yet it doesn't make sense though. I can't eat like that anymore, and yet I'm still fat. So it doesn't make sense to me. It's unfair, to be honest. If I'm going to be fat, at least let me eat as much.
Just let me do it properly.
Exactly. although in McDonald's's favor, they added the breakfast wrap again.
And they did.
I had 2 of those this morning, and I was very happy.
The morning they came back, I went with my lovely girlfriend, and I got 4. And I ate every single one of them in about 8 minutes. I didn't even breathe. I was just, they are the best thing in the world.
I was so happy. Mine was like so stuffed as well. And I don't know if it's just like I got someone really new working there and don't know how to put it together. And they just rammed this thing full of everything. It was glorious. It was a good day. It's been a very good day. The other thing, KFC, when they had gone away with the buns, now they're just like the chicken.
Chicken
was the buns instead. That was a day one purchase as soon as that was available. I was all in on that.
I remember one time they released that, like they released it or brought back onto the menu on my birthday, and I was in Edinburgh for my birthday, and I went, right, midnight, let's go. Well, not midnight, but like early hours in the morning, let's go and try and get one. It was brilliant.
We were probably doing it maybe not around about the same time, but on the same day, because of course we do share a birthday. So
we do share a birthday, yeah.
So we were probably doing, on the 2nd of July, we were both in KFC at some point, different KFCs, right, ordering the, what was it called? Double Down or something like that?
Yeah, the Double Down. I think it was a Double Down. It's like 2 chicken breasts and then like turkey bacon in the middle. And
2 breasts. Sure,
see when we're done here. Do you want to go to KFC?
Hey. Hey. Don't you be saying that chat to me, because you know we will. That's a dangerous game.
I'm up for it. Billy, just meet us at KFC, all right? We'll continue this there.
I was going to say, what here will be shut now? Bastards. Anyway, right. Anyway, sponsor me KFC. I'll take a sponsorship as well if you're throwing them out, even though I've slid you off.
Sponsorships for everyone.
It's not the Elgin one. It's Inverness. I'll take a sponsorship from the Inverness one. I have lost my utter train of thought because we started talking about chicken and I'm all gone. So big lads, then. You had a match at some point. There we go. Right.
Eventually.
So according to this, it was Fair City you had your first match together, but I'm thinking I can't be right if you're formed in Power Pro as it's now known. So first match as a team, was it everything you wanted and more?
Kerr, I'll let you lead this one actually.
Okay. yes, but no, I think it was a match that it made us understand how to work together, if that makes sense. Like, we had all this imagination and ideas of stuff we wanted to do, but when we actually went to put it in, we were like, how does this work? We're like, how do we actually make it make sense? How do we... And then the first one, it was really good match. It was at Studio 8. That was our first match, wasn't it? Studio 8 versus Parma.
Yeah, that was our first match together.
Yeah. And it was, I thought it was really good match. But then it really just went back and thought. And it, after that, things started clicking of what we need to do, when we need to do it. And it just kept clicking.
Was there any teams that you guys kind of tried to draw inspiration from? So I'm thinking two big lads, around about the scene, I'm thinking automatically like Viking Raiders, or if we're going back a little bit further in time, your Demolition, things like that. But was there anything that you guys tried to grab or were told to maybe have a look at to inspire you?
I know that Kerr very much wanted to take a little bit of magic from Team 3D. And
that doesn't shock me.
I knew that from the get-go. We have since started looking more into, War Machine or the Viking Raiders, to try and, get... Because a lot of people just say to us, you should definitely watch their stuff and, take some inspiration. Myself, though, this is bad. I always forget the name of the team, and it's such an easy name to remember. But I always liked looking at... No, not them. Dr. Steve Williams and who was his partner again? This will annoy me, and I'll come back to it. But yeah, I think Billy might know who I'm on about.
I've still got cage match up, so I'll just find it that way. I'll just be lazy that way.
I'm there we go, perfect.
Hang on, that's looked up Stone Cold Steve Austin. That is the wrong one.
I mean, he's always an inspiration for everything. So
yeah.
Yeah, I'm forgetting the name of it, but there's obviously a lot of teams out there like we look at, but when it comes to heavyweight teams,
Miracle Violence Connection.
Miracle Violence Connection. There we go. But I think also what me and Kerr do is we typically tend to look at singles wrestlers as well and try and take from them personally and then see what works together. Like for myself, I tend to try and look at Gary Albright quite a lot because I like doing suplexes and I like being able to throw people about. And Kerr looks at a lot of people because Kerr is very talented and he can do flips and stuff. And I'm not jealous of that at all, Kerr. I'll be honest with you. I'm not jealous whatsoever.
Yeah, look, it's not my fault. I grew up watching... I have got a mix of Bully Ray... What was his? Oh, I can't remember his name. Was it Manic? Was that the boy at TNA? The one with the mask. It was David from the game, Manic.
Suicide at the time, but yeah, I don't know if we can get past that. I don't get monetized.
Yeah, I ignored saying I didn't want. I just said Manic. Just I didn't know what was going to happen if I said the other one. So we'll just stick with Manic. Oh gosh, Willie Matt, and then the GOAT, the greatest of all time, Jinder Mahal. Of course, he's the best.
I'm just imagining when you're saying that the job was heavily inspired Team 3D, as I expected in this half an hour we've been on this podcast so far. I'm just imagining that he's just came to your door one day with some camo trousers and just went, I've got an idea.
Surprisingly, he actually hasn't. It was, I remember though, so obviously Power Pro do twice a year with the student showcase as well, right before the Truth Show, or the day before the Truth Show. And I remember one of the ideas we were given was we were going to be in a six-man tag on this student show. And we got told, yeah, it's going to be used to and one of our other trainees, Kyle, who I think you've probably, if you've seen any clips from student showcase, it's Kyle Chaos. Is it Kyle Chaos? Jason Anarchy, sorry, Jason Anarchy. What was Kyle Chaos something? I don't know. But he goes under Jason Anarchy there. And I, for whatever reason, just thought to myself, this could be like this. Kerr's gonna love this. I said, why don't like we actually go and buy some camos, like us two? We'll be Team 3D, and Kyle can be Spike, because unfortunately Kyle is quite he's of a shorter stature than us. And I was like, all right, I'll run it past Andy first, and Andy was like, yes, do it. But things changed, and that did not happen, unfortunately. But it will happen eventually. We will get it.
We Kyle is the GOAT, and he will. He loves the idea of being our Spike Dudley.
Have you already kind of brainstormed when first little Spike Dudley was LSD in ECW? Have you already brainstormed some meaty pun to go with it?
we've been thinking of stuff, but I think we'll leave that for if it actually happens. So I don't want to spoil the surprise, you know.
Because I'm a big dork, Kyle Chaos is now wrestling as Eddie Castle. In Iron Girders. There's a fun fact.
Yeah, that's what you've done there, Craig.
Yeah, I was like, because his name's Kyle, obviously, I was like, it's just something to do with pandemonium and stuff like that. So anarchy, chaos, same thing, right?
I like it. It could have been Kyle Crazy. It's brainstorming for future as he's little Spike Dudley to you Dudley boys. Clearly you both have to be Bully Ray for obvious reasons.
Obviously, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Nobody's going, you Devon? No. Right, anyway, so
Devon is the GOAT. He's amazing.
We love Devon.
Yeah, but
Reverend
Devon. It may turn into, I remember in TNA when the James Gang at the time, or Voodoo King Mafia, I think they were called at the time, did their parody of Team 3D, and Billy Gunn was dressed as Devon. And it was it appropriate at the time? Definitely not appropriate now. TNA, I love you. And still do. You crazy bunch of kids. Especially when their social media is like the best. It doesn't matter what happens. Minutes after R-Truth won the tag titles last night, they already had a clip up of them winning tag titles with 3 Live Crew. I was like, so you guys are a team now. The big lads, you're big lad and about. What sparked the change between to go and meet Factory is because you were kind of thrown together as the big lads and you kind of wanted to strike out as a team of your own. What was the kind of spark for that?
I think it was mainly that we just kind of looked at each other, and then we looked around the scene as well, and kind of just said to ourselves, yeah, this is fine. I think we've got something good here. We're working well together. We have a good kind of look and a kind of gimmick. We had just started going meet down the ring and started doing the whole meet thing. But when we looked around and we seen other people, we were looking and thinking, right, we're big lads, but there's bigger lads out there. And what happens when we go up against, these other big lads? We're just lads at that point, aren't we? So we just kind of thought, well, we were already saying we were hailing from the Meat Factory, so let's just change it to the Meat Factory and see if that works. And I think it did. Kerr?
Yeah. Yeah. Pretty much spot there. Yeah, I think we looked at it a lot. We liked the big lads was, we liked it, but like Craig said, we looked at other teams and we just thought, this isn't going to work when we come against the more big boys. It's just not going to happen. So we went, what do we like? Food. What food do we like? Meat, right? Meat Factory, let's go for it. And it's just worked. It's we've really just, I think, switched into a new gear with the Meat Factory, and it's just working great.
I think Big E has a lot to answer for, though, because that's kind of where the big the explosion of meat. Is that a good phrase? We're going with it. The big explosion of meat on the internet, on the wrestle web, so to speak, is his big meaty man slapping meat comment on the, was it New Day podcast, I think it was.
It was. I remember it.
I loved that podcast when it was on.
It was so good. It was such a good podcast.
I don't know why WWE don't do that anymore, because they had that. They had Alexa Bliss had 3 episodes, but they were really good, 3 episodes. And all that kind of pre-pandemic, inter-pandemic stuff, like Edge and Christian show, even though it wasn't WWE, but it was kind of adjacent. I don't know why they don't do that kind of stuff anymore, because it was great. Anyway, yeah, so the big mighty meat, big meaty men, slapping meat, easy for me to say, became a thing. And was that what inspired the big meat chance to go with it?
I'll let you lead this thing, Kev.
I think what it was we all, when we were training together, we kind of thought we needed something. Like, every wrestler's got a pose, they've got something they do, they've got something they say, and we're just running with the slap in our chests. And I was like, I think we could add this. And at the time, we were the big lads, and it was Craig at the time. It might have been because that all that was going on in Big E, I don't know the timeline of it, but it was, he just went, we just shout meat, and then we'd done it. It got a decent reaction, and we thought, right, well, that's what it is now.
Fair enough. From that point onwards, like, your first proper, we had a little bit back and forth through things like iron girders as well, a little bit of like set up into match kind of thing. But your first meaty storyline, so pardon the pun, was with your coach, with Andy Roberts for Fair City Wrestling. So match with yourself, John, first. What was it like getting one-on-one in front of a crowd with Coach Andy?
It was the scariest thing I've ever done in my life. It was when I got that message that was going to happen. I was terrified because he's so good, and he's teaching you. It's your chance to show. It's not going to waste it. Hours and hours that he puts in to us in training school, and it was so nerve-wracking. I remember when we went out, you'd be able to see it if you watched Mask back. I was visibly shaking. And then it was as soon as we came together, and as soon as we walked up, I was like, "Yeah, this is it." And I remember I thought it was a really, really good match. And he's unreal to work with. I've not been in a ring with anyone better to work with. It was unreal.
And for yourself, Craig, I saw your match with Andy because I was at
Ardler Mania.
I was at Ardler Mania to see it. I took the train down. Got my train card out, went to go see it. Had an absolute bitch of a day, but I got to see your match with Andy. Was probably one of the best matches on the show. It was fantastic. And so what was like for you getting the ring with Andy again, front of it was a big crowd.
That was massive.
Ardler Complex.
So I probably had like a similar feeling to Kerr, where I was like, this is where I die today. Great. So like, it was again, Kerr says, Andy's a great trainer, an even better wrestler, and I'm trying not to swear, but I know we can. So, but a phenomenal like performer as well. He's a phenomenal worker, a great opponent, and yeah, I was just shitting myself when I got in there. I was like, "Fuck, what are we gonna do here?" But right, so. So probably not any relevance to this, but like I just remember during the match as well, like obviously, you know, we're doing it, it's great, we're getting good reactions, everything's, you know, syncing up in that. I just remember full force slapping him across the face and like knocking out one of his contact lenses, and I think, oh no, this is it, this is me, this is I'm, I was like, If I ever have to do like a card workout again, then I just know he's done it because of this reason. Like the next training session that I come in, I'm like, great, thanks. But yeah, it's one of those things where it's like it was scary, but it was so good, and probably one of the best matches I've had to date.
If it was the pop up, like when he was doing the Vader bomb kind of thing, and you caught him, I was just like, blew my mind watching it. Cause I was like, holy, because Andy's a big guy.
It blew my mind as well. Like, it also almost blew my knees as well. Like, oh, hang on a minute. I surprised myself with that as well. And like watching the back, I think, how did I do that? Like, because I'm never usually that fast. Kerr can attest to that. I'm not a fast person.
I don't know. KFC's about to close and you'd want something to eat and you'll get there quick.
I will get there very fast.
But again, it was one of those things where I remember it happening at the time, but I was like, yeah, I had an absolute killer of a day. So I thought, right, I'll wait until it comes out on Patreon, which it's available if you want to go check it out on Bear City Wrestling's Patreon channel. You can pay for it. I can't remember how much it is, but I've bought it. So it's in my purchase items anyway. And I watched it back and I was like, oh, it did happen. Holy shit. I thought I made it up in my head. I thought, that didn't happen really. And then there it was. But no, it was incredible. And then, of course, after the match, the Meat Factory came to give Andy a bit of a beat down because he was a bit of a bad bastard. And was that the first time, John, that you got back to the Ardler Complex, or had you wrestled there since?
The first time was when I wrestled with Andy.
Oh, right. Okay.
That was the first time I'd been back to, I like to still say, my home away from home, because it's an amazing venue. I love it. But yeah, that was the first time. So it was really cool for me to be back there as well. And then after the match, Andy decided to ruin it and just beat me up. It was
shocking.
I deserved it, I think.
But no, the Ardler Complex, yeah. I mean, for you, I actually wrestled in it. I think I did two very poor appearances in the ring for the Ardler Complex. And it was, yeah, going back there after, I think for me, it was about 10 years maybe. And yeah, you forget how big and spacious the venue is and all that kind of stuff.
So it's such a good venue for wrestling events. It's just perfect.
Yeah, it's one of those that, yeah, couldn't believe it had been that long since I've been to it. And as soon as I went there, I was like, yeah, I remember doing this journey and going to the shows and all that kind of stuff. It was a weird one. I mean, I suppose for yourself as well. You went away. You decided to go elsewhere and start from the bottom again, and now you're back to the Ardler Complex, and you're in the ring with quite frankly one of the best in the UK, certainly Scotland, but I would say UK as well. He's probably a name thrown about, should be thrown about quite often, is Andy Roberts. So that's, I suppose that would be paid to you doing that, going away, working from the bottom, and you're coming into a big match with Andy.
Yeah, I really, like, when I thought about that a lot, I'd mentioned it with family members and that when I said it was happening, and I just always thought it was really, really mental. And that's where I started, that's where I had my first match, and now I'm here after the first match. I was here for 7 years, 7 or 6.5 years from when I started to when I was back there at Adler, and it was, I remember going, I'm going to go and try and put on the best match I physically can, just this, and I watched back the first match. Watched back one with Andy, the difference was unreal. But I mean, I'd say it's 80% down to Andy, because he's unreal. He can explain how unreal he actually is in the ring. It's mental.
It's probably a nice little change, because you guys are the guys that throw the people, and Andy's quite adept at throwing people regardless of size. So was that kind of, yeah, a fun little challenge that you became the throwies? And not the throwers.
Did not have a say in the matter whatsoever. Like, there's the during, especially during my match with him, there's a bit where he's in the corner. I try and charge him. He manages to catch me into a belly to belly, turns me around, puts me down, and again, no say. Like, I closed my eyes, and when I opened them, I was on the floor, like halfway across the other side of the ring, going, oh, okay, so that happened. He's so strong. It's scary.
And he's typically strong.
And he's so, like, soft-spoken when you meet him as well. It's like, this doesn't compute, you know? When you meet him and he's just, like, really nice and soft-spoken, and then you go watch him wrestle and he's just, like, just throwing everyone. And
yeah.
God, this...
He's a nice guy. Just don't fuck with him.
Yeah.
That seems like a good mantra to go by, just in general, as well. So, Meat Factory are now rocking and rolling. I haven't got a pun, and I'm starting to shut down. I'm not sure. I'm all good. But yeah, so you're rocking and rolling. You're facing some of the teams, the established teams in Scotland. Your Termination Z. I was going to say Z. Dado's going to not be happy with that. Termination Z, the Par. As well, who's kind of your nemesis at the moment in Power Pro, with their golf caddy, Mr. Manaville. So you're venturing out and properly taking on these established teams, and is that pretty much your goals now, is to take on all these teams that are about? So you've seen Brutales, etc. You know, is that your, we've got a checklist?
I 100% think that's what we want to do. I think that's the goal for this year, is get out and get against as many people as we can. But I mean, there's loads of people you could mention in mind that you'd love to have a match with, but I want all of them. I want all the smoke. I want them all.
Yeah. I'd say, yeah, but it's definitely one of those things where it's like, we want to just wrestle everyone. We want to obviously get better, and the only way to do that is to wrestle the best. I'd also say, though, to add on to that, like, we don't want to just wrestle people like in Scotland. We want to be everywhere. Like, I got the opportunity to go to Ireland last year and wrestle over there just for like 2 days, and one of the best experiences of my life, and I want to share that with Kerr. I just want to do it more often. It doesn't have to be overseas. It could be England, Wales, you know, any of those two. But obviously, we want to go overseas. Like, we want to go everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, just there's a list of tag teams we want to wrestle. Some of them we've already wrestled, and we want rematches with. You know, one team in particular. But we'll cross our bridge when we get to it.
Speaking of that, then, your tour in Ireland, it was for Mega Slam, wasn't it? Because Power Pro have got this kind of working relationship now with Mega Slam. Announced after your match. One of your opponents being BT Gunn in one of the matches that you had there, which reminds me of the story that Kate Calloway told me. Because so she was interviewed her a couple of weeks, a week or so ago, I can't remember. And she mentioned you were one of the first people she met. And it was a chop circle. And you were scared to chop her. And she kind of cajoled
you. Scared to chop her? I wasn't scared to chop her. It was more like, right, this is her first experience. I don't want to, like, because you don't know how people are going to take it. Like, in case of, like, when I chop people, I chop them. Like, it's, you know, man, woman, I don't care. As long as, like, you know, you're okay with it, I'll do it, kind of thing. But I was like, I don't want this to be like, you know, her first impression of that. And she was like, yeah, like, I remember it was like that whole Shinsuke Nakamura thing. Like, yeah, man. I'm like, all right, you asked for it. Bump. And yeah, that was the first time I met her. And we've been friends ever since.
That's learning about wrestlers is that, to be honest, you're all a weird bunch because you like to hurt yourself for our entertainment, which, you know, it's mad, but I'll still watch it. But yeah, the weirdest things bring you together as friends, which, like, well, for you guys, it was eating. And, you know, it's just one of those weird things. But yeah, I mentioned BT Gunn, of course, who's got a reputation for having some of the hardest chops in the country. Were you faced with them at all?
Luckily, no. Thank God for that. Yeah, the only time I managed to get locked up with BT was the final match on the final show, where, like, they had a big like battle royal type deal. It was Team Nasty versus Team Mega Slam. So obviously, you know, me, Andy, and Niwa were representing Team Nasty at that point. Nasty, like that kind of stuff. And you know, unfortunately, BT was on Team Mega Slam, and they just managed to get the upper hand, and there was never really enough time for them to chop me, thankfully.
So the only chops you're willing to avoid?
I mean, if he wanted to, he could chop me. I wouldn't mind. Like, it's just a case. Like, I say that now, but then he'll chop me and I'll go, why did I agree to that?
I really brought that up because I thought of the meat pun of avoiding chops. I thought, it's fine, I'm going to throw that in there just for my own amusement, because I do love a pun.
Just while I'm remembering though, Kerr, you actually owe me some chops here. Like, not me, like, you don't get to chop me, but, like, you have to take some chops from me now, because back in December, I remember you, I don't know if you had chopped Andy or if you chopped Tommy Cartel, but I remember you tagged out immediately after that, and then I had to, you know, get the receipts for your chops. So
game's the game. When you're a team, when there's a team, there's a bit of give and go, you know what I mean?
If it was anybody else, I don't think I would have minded, but Andy's got a heck of a chop on him, so...
He She does. Yeah, it was. It was.
There was five props in there.
So I remember a match in December against Andy and Tommy Cartel, and I chopped him, and I thought he's got such a big chest. It's so good for chopping, does Mr. Cartel. I remember I leathered that man. I heard him as he hit the floor, and I was like, oh. And I remember I just picked him up and tagged out, and then here comes Andy, and he belted Craig, and I was trying to hold it out. I was laughing. I was like, oh, that's kind of my bad, that one. I've started something here. It was very funny.
Yeah, I seen how concerned you were when I looked across the ring afterwards, and you were eating a trifle. No joke, Billy, you was eating a trifle. Like, full on.
You can't offer me a trifle. I'm going to take it.
I wasn't angry that you had a trifle. I was angry that you didn't have one for me. Like,
That's what happens when you get a wee individual fruit trifle. You've just got to.
It was Christmas season. I got a trifle. You were doing an amazing job lying on the floor getting beaten up. So I was just taking a quick break. I mean, what's wrong with that?
Just looking away, ignoring it. Just if they don't give me eye contact, they won't chop me. It's fine. I just won't look. It won't happen. So we'll go to the questions, which I haven't looked out. So this is going to be just horrific. Me trying to find all these questions. Right. Let's see. We'll go to Facebook first because I always forget to go there. We have
seen some of these questions.
Quite possible. I've got a couple through Instagram, and I've got to Google the wording of one of them because it's Ian Skinner. Right. Okay. So we'll start with Facebook. We've got Patrick Petersky asking, "What is the best meat?"
Us, obviously. Yeah. Right.
The meat factory. That's the best.
That's one. There has been some responses. Someone has responded with baby. You know, the other white meat. So there's that. But from what I've learned, if we're not taking yourselves into account, it's chicken, because we're all after that KFC sponsor.
Oh, yeah. Chicken. Yeah. Chicken. I'm going to put a shout in there for lamb, though. Lamb is unreal.
See, I've only ever had lamb in Donner form. I find it kind of sweaty otherwise. Is there a particular way for lamb for you that kind of I could introduce myself to it?
Oh, right. I want to introduce something, right? A lamb korma from an Indian is the goat. You will not find a better munch. A bit of garlic naan, a bit of peel of rice. You'll never get anything better. That's the goat.
See, that's I used to like getting, because I don't really prepare prawns at home because it's not something that we have often enough. But I used to like getting a prawn curry from an Indian because he just hit the spot right. You know, yeah. So I will add lamb in there. Just a try next time we do an Indian. Great. Yeah. We've got Tom Atlas. Asking, when will Tom Atlas fully be a member of the Big Lads? But they don't exist, so I don't know.
When he gets, I don't know, Kara. What do you think? When can he join the Big Lads?
I mean, I love Tom. Tom is one of my favorite people in the world. But fair is fair. He's got to do the initiation.
Like, that's true. Yeah,
so he's got to get at least 7 plates at the Beijing banquet. And then he's allowed in to the meat factory. That is the rules.
That is true, yeah. 7 plates or more.
7 plates as well. No. We've got to be there to witness.
Coming on there. No, you have to fill them up. You got a mountain of food.
That's the initiation.
There we go. And Body Guy Brandon has added just a picture with you guys. And instead of meat factory, it says feet. So there we go. That's
yeah. Yeah, he showed us that.
Seat factory.
I like that he probably just held his phone up to you and just went.
Hey, and we took it at the last show, and then we went to the one next one. He's like, "Oh, look what I made to show us this," and I had no clue what reaction. And I was like, "The feet factory. Okay, well, this is a thing now."
Yeah, that's just your OnlyFans side hustle if you so wish to choose it.
It's only Nans. It's when we go to Nando's.
Only Nans. Oh, yeah, that's it.
We've talked about starting like a podcast and just doing it in different eating places and calling it Only Nans, because I think that's slap.
Let me tell you about Scottish Wrestling Network. We like to host some different podcasts. I am all in on Only Nans. So yeah, Send it. I want it. Ian Skinner. He has asked. Would you rather have unlimited bacon but no more video games, or games, unlimited games, but no more games?
He's asked me this before, like in person, a few times.
How does he memorize it? Because he's asked it every bloody time.
Every time there's been like a seminar or we're at a show, he comes up and asks that question. I'm like, so no, I give him the same answer.
I'm like, still not even 100% sure what the question was.
The correct answer is the second one, as far as I'm aware, because it doesn't state that you can't have bacon. So
he did send going, this will be easy for them. So I'm assuming that's going to be.
I'd say so.
And plus, you're a board game guy, so you've still got your games as well.
Yeah, so I've still got my games, unlimited games, you know, and no games, but it doesn't say anything about bacon, so I can have my bacon.
There you go. And Judas Gray, we've got Handsome Man's Club match when?
Yeah, just name it. Like, but here's the thing, right? Here's the thing. Like, there might be a bit of contention with Ashley Vega there, because like whereas this has never like happened on a match before, we've always like kind of had that chat with Ashley as well, where we've jokingly been saying like, oh, we need to like make a faction and call ourselves Meat and Dessert. So her words, not ours, by the way, just before anything goes out there. So I don't know if that's like a stipulation for the match or not, or she has to run back and forth between both teams.
Like you know? Half and half gear, and just like turns to the right to support you, and turns to the left to support exactly, Hans Mans Club.
I'd definitely be up for that. You know, I love Sam Barber and that, and love Judas and that. I've not met Ronan yet, so that'll be interesting. But yeah,
I will tell you in all honesty, Ronan's really nice, but you'll love chopping him. You know, that kind of way.
Oh, I was gonna say, any excuse I get to chop Judas Gray, I'm there and I'm taking it.
Same.
That's why I love him, but I love chopping him more.
I fully support that thought, because I love Judas Gray. I speak highly of him. If anyone asks, however, last few times I've seen him, he's thrown stuff at me. So I'm happy to see people chop him in return. So that's fine.
We'll get him for you. But yeah, any promotions want to do that, just heads up. Why not? I'm up for that.
So you mentioned wanting to get out there. So you mentioned wanting to get out there and just wrestle UK-wide, I'm assuming Europe and the world. But is there any teams that specifically you're like, yeah, get me with them? I'm just thinking off the top of my head, you guys in Meat Wagon, just to rank up the meat factor to 11. You know, to have you just all
too much meat.
It's funny. We were on a show with Meat Wagon back last year. It was September, end of September, at CPW, and they were on the show as well. I believe they were still called Synergy at the time. Yeah, I think they were still booked as Synergy at the time. But like, I remember like we had that kind of funny moment of being like, oh yeah, like I'll use Meat Wagon, Meat Factory, like, oh, we need to get that match together, or like, oh, or even just like do like an 8-man tag or something like that. And now they're back to being called Meat Wagon, so it's like, well, it has to happen now, right? Surely.
At this point.
Yeah, like, come on. Other than them though, I'd say maybe well, obviously Kerr's got, I mean, kind of the same ideas for like what teams we'd want to do, but I think there might be one or two different ones in there. So, like, obviously, I think we're both for Kings of the North first and foremost. Yeah. They are phenomenal. Skull Brawl, I would like to do Skull Brawl because love Caleb, and Aspen seems like really nice and solid. So, like, everything like that. KOE, I think, are really good as well, and I think we could do great stuff with them as well. It's quite a lot, to be honest. Like, Kerr, yourself, have I mentioned any more that you're
thinking of? AT and Kez, I think they're still tag team.
Yeah.
So, yeah. That's it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm trying to think who else.
Casino Brutale as well.
Yes.
I really like, so they've been training a few times with us at Power Pro, and just getting to work with them has been really fun. So obviously we just want to like batter them today. Like, but if we want to batter you, like if we want to batter you, then yeah, we like you. But if we want to kill you, then it's, you know, hang on a minute. You know, so if we say we want to batter you, it's all in good fun. God, I'm trying to remember all the tag teams that I want to face.
We're so lucky. John,
it's because Foundation Future was very high on that list, but we got the amazing opportunity to wrestle not too long ago. So, and they were also good, not their unreal as well. But they were the list.
We do want to rematch with them as well, though. Hopefully soon before they do lose those, you know, or if they ever lose those tag team titles, for example, FCW, like, we definitely want to be the ones to take them from them. Mm-hmm. So we really want that rematch sooner rather than later, because obviously we want to wrestle as much as possible as well. Billy, who would you like to see us wrestle?
Well,
like,
it's just
to throw it back at you.
You mentioned Community Pro Wrestling, and they've got their tag team tournament. It'll be like next week, I think, as this goes out, and it's ridiculous, you know. When I was going through the list of teams on there, shocked you guys weren't on that. Just saying, that could have changed by the time this comes out. I'm bringing up the list now. And it's our second podcast in the season that someone's mentioned Aspen and I haven't in an episode. And that gets that biased accusation out of the way for me. So that's fine. So they've got teams like Foundation. So you guys wrestled Ryan Riley and Zach Dynamite. Yeah. So
yeah,
you can't get Brad in there somewhere, because I think that's just ultimate meat.
Yeah, well, I mean, if they get Brad, then we need to take Hunter Sampson with us, right? So that'll do us. Come on now,
Someone book that.
Foundation want the rematch, but they want Brad. We'll happily bring our big boy as well. We'll bring a bit of Hunter Sampson.
Our big lad. There we go.
Our big lad.
Bring it back full circle.
You know what? I reckon Hunter Sampson would look really good, and he's a handsome man anyway. But I think he'd look really good in like a butcher's kind of apron, and you know, mind Southpaw regional
apron, all right? Yeah,
just that only.
Just a bit different, yeah.
Mind Southpaw regional wrestling? They had, I think it was Seth Rollins and Rhino, were like the butchers, you know, that kind of thing. Just the aprons and the bloody white shirts and all that. So I think Hunter Sampson, like I say, handsome man, could rock that quite well. Just going through my 12 tag teams to watch in 2024 article. Because that was a lot easier for me to write than the 24 for 24. Because I started writing and I was like, there's too many and I'll offend someone. And it was really, it got made me sad. So I went, tag teams, I could do that. You got teams like the Good Times, Up in Disco, Down in Disco, Monstrum, Rob Stowe, that's another big meaty combo. Arcade Violence, I really like what they do. I like Arcade Violence.
We got them in a six-man tag. When was that again?
Of course you did.
That was with Gallo. We had Gallo.
They had Leon Graves.
But obviously we would want to have them in a normal tag match as well, see what we can do, because with a six-man, there's lots of different factors. So,
of course. Legends Never Die as well. Again, they're a bit of a chaotic team to throw in there. I didn't do it in any particular order, so for anyone who goes, oh, the number, whatever, but you guys are like third in the list. There two were Arcade Violence and Casino Brutal. But you got, we're Risky Business as well. That would be actually just probably almost a day off for you guys for the lifting side of things. Catching in there as well. But Scotland right now is just ridiculous. That's all teams that haven't won titles as I was writing it. The tag team division in Scotland is just incredible right now, and we're very lucky as fans to be able to go in and go right tag team wrestling outfit as well. I can't forget the guys up in the Northeast outfit, the tag team titles, tag team champions up here. Again, two big guys. It's usually Ted O'Keefe and Murphy, but Dino's in there as well, and he's a big lad. So a lot of big tag teams, a lot of big lad tag teams going about in Scotland to get your teeth into. Get your claws into, so to speak. Why is that a catchphrase today? But it's right now with things like the Forbidden Door and all that, those kind of cliched words, really is, and seeing teams that Community Pro are bringing in from Ireland and from Europe as well, it's generally the world's your oyster when it comes to tag team wrestling, it seems.
Mm-hmm.
not good food. It's not really a meat either. I don't know if you guys are oyster fans. But yeah, so worldwide, is there an end game? Is there an end goal for the meat factory? Is it to be signed to a promotion, or is it just to take it as it comes?
Oh, that's a question.
Craig, I'll let you go. Oh, you let me take it, right. I think it depends, because, like, yeah, I think me and Kerr have different ideas for, like, how we'd want maybe things to go. Because I remember speaking with Kerr, and I was like, we both kind of both said, like, oh, if this is how it goes from now on, where it's like, you know, we get bookings every now and again, we get to live out our dream, then yeah, that's great. Perfect, fine. I know personally myself, I want to take this as far as I can take it. Kerr's most likely the same as me on that front. You know, in an ideal, perfect world, that's how everyone, I think, wants to do it. Me personally, on myself, I would love to, right, put it this way, if I could say I wrestled in Japan, I'll be happy. I will die a happy man. If I can say anything more than that, then yeah, that's it. I'll hit game over. I'll be like, cool, this is it. We're good. But end game for Meat Factory is, yeah, just fuck it. Let's get signed. Yeah, I'd say let's just get signed.
That's changed.
Yeah, it's changed now. I've changed my mind halfway through this answer, where I'm just like, yeah, end game. Screw it. We're gonna get signed. That's it.
Start in New Japan and then work your way from there, and then you can just tick off your dreams as you go at the same time.
Yeah, exactly.
Craig, you've changed the goal drastically here, because beforehand it was we just want to wrestle in as many different countries, and now we're getting signed. So what's the goal?
Well, that's
here?
How it starts. Go get signed first, bro.
Okay, I'll let you off then.
Yeah, and yourself, Kerr?
When I started, I'd always just said I want to wrestle in as many different countries as I can, because I think that would be. I love traveling, and I want to. I love food, so I'd love the opportunity to wrestle in all these different countries and taste all the different cuisines and just have a great time and travel with my best friend, oh. Billy Strachan.
Oh no! I think we've got a certain vibe in the last hour or so. I think we've got a little bit of a friend. Sorry, Craig. You don't have to change anything for, you don't have to change any calendar for buying gifts or anything. Same birthday, you know, it all works out.
Okay. It's fabulous. Yeah. It's easy for everyone.
I'm going to go see Stone Malone after this. I'm going to start a brother tag team with him. So, how about that?
I'll keep the E-Factory going with Alfie. You know what I mean?
Do it if you want. Like, you know, I'm still his favourite, just so you know.
That's true, yeah.
Oh, and spoilers, because it hasn't gone out as we're recording, but that was Kate Calloway's favourite member of the Meat Factory as well.
Alfie. Yeah. He's my favorite member of the Meat Factory, so
certainly now after this revelation that
I'm not even my favorite member of the Meat Factory. It's fine.
So going forward, I've seen the time and we've rambled for. I'm always afraid when I've got like maybe four things written down here, thinking, oh shit, we're not going to speak about much, and then here we are, hour 15 later,
Let's just keep going. Come on.
We'll just do live thing at the pre-show. We'll just go. There you go. There's CM Punk.
Yeah.
It is. I don't know. I've never watched any live commentary of shows or anything like that on YouTube. I just feel like a lot of it would be. Oh, JBL's yes. There. Doug Dimino.
I watched quite a lot of it.
Oh my god, it's Booker T. Like kind of thing, you know.
Yeah. So, there was again. Absolute tangent, but I don't know if you saw the pre-show for last night. CM Punk was doing the speaking. There was a sign behind them, and someone had written 619 on it, but they got really arrogant with that first six because the six was huge. The one was there, and the nine was like really squashed in at the side. And I was looking at it going, oh, you got arrogant with that first one. That was you thought you had a lot more space with the
you
rest.
You got
of that.
Confident.
That's the sort of shit I like about wrestling. Just looking at the backgrounds and going, no. Oh. It's like seeing people with belts at shows. I've started. I was that guy once upon a time.
I used to be that guy.
And then you see it a few times, you go, no. I'll take it if I'm going to a meet and greet. If I'm going to get it signed, cool. But I'm not wearing the belt. It'll go in my bag, and that's where it'll stay. Anyway, there goes my extra tangent for the evening. Your merch, it's got a big pig on it. Sorry, I was really blunt about it. You got loads of merch. Got
a horrible thing to say about calf. Come on now.
The old school wrestler on the front with some flames or something in the back. The merch designs though. So you've got quite a few different designs, but the logo itself is the pig in the middle and meat factory and what have you. So how did that come about?
Kerr didn't want a cow.
I suppose you didn't want a chicken.
That's not 100% true. I didn't want the cow because the cow that Craig originally chose looked too much like the Brahma Bull.
Fair enough.
I was like, that's too close.
Well, the way you worded it to me was, I don't want a cow. Everyone's got a cow. And I'm like, all right, okay.
Yeah, everyone does have a cow. No one has a pig. Who has a pig? A pig? Who has a pig? The meat factory. They've got a pig.
There you go. As far as other designs go, is it just I know for myself when I'm doing my wee t-shirt store, which people can go into tmail.com/ScottResnet, that I just kind of go, oh, I like this idea, just make it, and then goes up. That's pretty much my MO with that sort of thing. Is that you guys as well going, I like this?
That's me.
It's
literally a case of Craig will send me screenshots of a design, and I'll be like, yeah, that's good, and then it's just up. Or I was just going, I've got this idea, and then next thing I know, I go on it, and it's there. And I'm like, all right, okay.
Have you got a personal favourite that came to you in the night? I'm just trying to bring it up myself so I can
have a look-see. The straight out of meat one, I think, was my favourite.
Oh, yeah.
It's in a blue and red t-shirt.
Yeah.
See, I like
the red ones that I like really like.
Yeah. I just like that one. And...
the Meat 316 one, that's the best.
Oh, we love that one as well, yeah.
I like it's meat time. I think it's just I do like the welcome to meat because I'm fed up of black t-shirts in wrestling, mainly because I've got a lab cross beagle who's got really blonde hair. So like black t-shirts now are ruined kind of thing. Yeah. So give me a color. I like that one. So that's for everyone.
You've got blue and red ones there as well. So, just.
There we go. So you go to the-meat-factory.tmail.com or just go to Craig Berry's Twitter. It's the pinned tweet at this moment in time. So that's easiest way instead of typing all that out. Right. I think it's, unless there's anything specific you thought I was going to ask, I think we can kind of start wandering our way to the end. But is there anything that you guys want to bring up with each other, a bit of Jerry Springerness? There's been a little bit of tension so far already with the mission of Craig's no longer John's best friend. But is there anything else you want to get off your chest before we all wrap up?
Care? Anything?
You got something?
I mean, I'm trying to think of something just for comedy's sake, but
it's not your strong suit, Craig.
Yeah, I'm not a great thinker. I love you, man. So I think we're good.
You see each other in about 10 minutes anyway at KFC. So
probably, yeah. Just how about if you're gonna give a chop out, maybe take one. How about that?
Think about it.
Anyway. Anyway, but no, this has been an absolute fantastic chat. I'm glad that we finally got a date for it and we're all available and wide awake for it. And I think I've done well. I've done well, personally. Pat myself on the back, Barry Horowitz style. Just still awake, guys. Still awake, guys. I'm going to put Twitter. I'll fall asleep by the time the Drew Rollins match finishes, probably tonight. But plug your stuff. I've already plugged the T-Mill store for your merch, but where else do you want to find? Where else do you want people to find you guys? Obviously not your home addresses, but where do people want to find you?
Any KFC in Fife, you will find us.
Where there's chicken, there'll be meat. Let's go. Kerr, you go first.
I only really use Instagram because I don't get Twitter and I'm not funny. Twitter's for funny people. So you find me on Instagram at John Kerr PW. That's me. I've only got Instagram, like it says.
I can confirm that there is people on Twitter that are not funny as well, so don't worry about that. Anyway, sorry, Craig.
That's fine. I can also confirm that there's no funny people not a lot of funny people on Twitter because I'm on Twitter. So Yeah, Facebook, it will be Greg Berry Wrestler. For the Facebook page, please do not add my real profile. I've had a few of them recently. That's scary. Instagram is Craig Berry 101, and that's the same for Twitter. And you can find links to the Meat Factory T-Mail store, both on Instagram and on Twitter. And yeah, that's that. I don't think there's anything else. And the book Craig Berry Wrestler at craigberrywrestler@gmail.com.
And that's the best way that you get you both guys as well, probably.
Exactly.
Yeah, easily. Excellent. Well, thank you very much for taking time to speak with me today.
No worries.
Thank you very much for inviting us on.